So here we are, learning cryptography through hand ciphers, or the encryption 101, or how to take your data away from the bureaucrats, or whatever you want. I guess this is one of the most important things in digital life at this moment. And if you care about privacy, oh gosh, I'm chasing people away already. If you care about privacy, then you need to have the tools to protect yourself. Well, the poll already showed in the previous lecture how to do that with the UDP stack. And this is another tool by using encryption, making sure that somebody else cannot read it. And of course, that you know that who is sending the data is also really sending the data. I shouldn't have had that beer, I guess. It's not too complex. That's the main message. If you want to know what am I all about for this hour, basically it's not too complex. So if you want to go get a beer. But this is the program to get to this conclusion. Who's bullshitting today? That's me. Why do we care about cryptography? Then we'll take a look and we'll go back to history. Because history will teach us that it's easy to use encryption and you can use the tools each and every day, even without a computer. So if you're filling up your diary, you can use encryption as well. So even if police were to go through your diary, I don't know why they would go through mine, but suppose they would, they couldn't read it. Actually, as I told you already, I'm an ADHD guy, so you can't read my handwriting anyhow. And then, of course, if we know how the system works, what are we going to do with our knowledge? Well, first about me, really quick. Who am I? I'm Brenno de Winter from the Netherlands, 34 years old, single male, open source minded, freedom loving, technology savvy, stubborn, community playing, overactive, news junk. That's just about me that I wanted to say. And I started at programming at the age of 6. I write for a whole bunch of magazines. And basically what I'm about is sharing knowledge. So I give training as well. Okay, enough about me. The other slides will take a little bit longer. Why on earth do we care about cryptography? By the way, who uses cryptography nowadays? Okay, now that's in the very back corner. That's it's a kind of a strange group there. They don't use cryptography, they think. I hope they buy a lot of stuff online. What? Okay, whatever. Why cryptography? It's basically a security tool that helps us keep secret. And it helps us doing authentication. That is basically the most important part of all. It's hot over here, isn't it? I can verify that you are the person you're claiming to say. But more importantly, encryption is a privacy tool. And that is the most important part for me. Privacy? I've got nothing to hide. Well, you've got a lot to hide. And I'm happy to tell you what the things are that you want to hide, if you buy me a beer. But more importantly, and I said that yesterday as well, privacy is a human right, and it's a safeguard against things that happened in the past with certain regimes, and we don't want to see happening again. It's basically a right that we have, and you can't take that just away for the sake of so-called security. Basically, it makes it possible to be an activist. Basically, I can be part of a mailing list because I have a government that isn't spying on me. Basically, I can meet with a group of people, start a flash mob, because the government is not going to prevent me. It also protects us from totalitarian regimes. Well, if you're in the eastern part, what used to be the eastern German part of Berlin, I don't think I need to explain that much more. But it's also needed for the freedom of speech. I told you I'm a journalist. I can tell you that I had 4 big riots this year in the Netherlands that I could write up because people within the government leaked information to me. They did that because they had to trust that their name would not be printed and they wouldn't find out. A couple of those riots changed policy. One of them was with an open source agency called OSOS, and that was meant to promote open source, and it turned out they were withholding documents. Because somebody leaked that information, I could investigate it, and the agency had to start a new policy. They had to kick out the program manager because of that. That is only possible when people are able to share information without a government shooting them down. It's also useful to have a personal life, and it protects me from data theft and crimes. The question is actually really, who do we award with privacy and who should be transparent? And there are 2 parties, there's the government and there's us, and you fill it in. Am I afraid of my government? Well, I'm Dutch, so yes. We have lawful interception in the Netherlands, and we don't know for sure, but there are indications that per person that we have in our nation, the Dutch government is wiretapping more than the Stasi did during the Eastern Germany period. If that is true, then at least what I expect, if they're wiretapping my phones, that they at least protect the data a little bit. Well, a study learned that they don't. We've got district attorney in our country who plays their computer with sensitive investigation data and kiddie porn on the street. We've got agents with the military police sharing files on the internet using Gaza. What the fuck is Gaza being used for on such a computer? The research documents were about people talking in high sensitive cases. That means that their life is at stake. I mean, I'm making a joke about it, but basically their life is at stake. Because somebody wants to use Gaza. We've got laptops of agents that are stolen from police agencies and turn out to be unencrypted. And if you don't steal it from a police agency, you can always pick up your laptop in a train, because we've got people from the Secret Service in the Netherlands that leave the laptop in the train. If they don't leave it in the train, then they put information on a floppy disk. I didn't even know that we have floppy disks back in the Netherlands, but apparently we do. And they leave that in a rental car. And together with state secrets, they put a personal resume on that same floppy disk. Now, just wonder yourself, how can data be so mixed up that you've got personal data and state secrets on the same floppy disk? That's at least interesting. And there is basically only little democratic control on the Secret Service. Well, in that environment, you do want to protect yourself from a government that is going too far. And encryption is one of the means to keep it within your own hands. If you want to go to my data, go through me first. May I ask you, on your computer, if you use any OS, Windows, Linux, or Macintosh, who is encrypting their personal data on their laptop? Wow, that's a high number. Generally, if I ask it in a training, I'm the only one standing like this. Some people don't even know that you can encrypt your data with Windows. Now, I know that Windows and encryption and I know that, but still, it's at least some protection. So we start to work on hand ciphers. It's good to understand that cryptography is not something that was invented last month or last year by some company, but that we have had it for ages. Actually, it's nothing new. So if they try to outlaw it, they try to outlaw something that we have had for thousands of years. The only thing you need is pen and paper. Well, the most famous way of encrypting is the Caesarean rotation, or ROT. And what does ROT mean, basically? I take the alphabet and I shift the characters by X places. And the most famous one is ROT 13. So, you take the alphabet, you get this alphabet in return, and basically you go for a chaos computer camp, then you go like C becomes a P, etc. Oh, that's too emotional for them, I guess. You basically... Wrong remark, very wrong remark. Basically, this is the way that it looks. It's very easy to crack, as you can imagine, but it has still been used in 2001. Has anybody ever heard of Dmitry Sklyarov? It's a Russian person. It's kind of funny, he was speaking at DEF CON. I was there with other journalists, and then we were going through the program. And then somebody said, like, shall we go to his lecture? And I looked at it and I said, like, man, not really interesting, because he's using ROT 13, and that's not really rocket science, now is it? After his lecture, 2 days later, he was apprehended by the FBI, because he cracked a secured device. He was cracking Adobe files, and they were protected with ROT 13. Talking about good security, it's of course easy to crack, because you've got 26 options, and that's of course, if you've got a longer text, really easy to guess. It is, however, a good starting point, because you're making a minimal level of security, really minimal. But maybe you need a little bit more random information. So that's why we have the monoalphabetic substitution. I always have to look, because it's kind of hard to pronounce. Basically what you do is the same as ROT, but this time you take the letters and you randomly place them in the table. So legal becomes ZCRBZ. And of course now you're totally secure, because you got 26 times 25 times 24 times 23, etc. possibilities. So the level of security definitely goes up. But are we totally secure? No, not really. Because did you ever play Hangman? If you're playing Hangman, what letter would you name the first? Why? Yes, that's most common. There are statistics. Everybody knows that in Western European languages, the E is the most used character.
But
not in the word legal.
Your example?
Well, there's an E in legal.
One.
Yep. Absolutely right. That's why we call it statistics. Based on the Dutch language, and I know you all speak Dutch, or like to pay double Dutch, these are the characters. If you take 1,000 characters on random, out of ordinary sentences, 159 average would be an E, and then indeed an N and an A and a T. Write it down or go to my website, dwinter.com, there's the presentation, because this is the way to play Hangman. In the 9th century, The security of the substitution, blah blah. Yeah, it's after Sesame Street, and then I'm always a little bit slow. It was cracked, and there was no solution for nearly 600 years. So we're there with encryption that worked somewhat without a solution. Ultimately, somebody thought of a new system, basically having a shared key. What's that? Well, we're communicating, we want to do it secure. So we are exchanging a key. Now you have to think back to 1553, because if I want to share information with somebody in Berlin, I can't go to klm.nl and buy an 89 euro ticket. I mean, I have to send a letter with somebody on a horse, and that has to travel for so many days. During this time, the shared key is vulnerable to an attack. Because what guarantees me that nobody will read the shared key? But still, it makes it a little bit easier, because this is your encoding mechanism, and this is actually something you ought to copy, because it's really easy to use. You can print this really small, you can put it in your wallet, and you've got a perfect encryption device. Now, it's really a good encryption device. And the idea is this. Now you can see who's German and who's not. My secret word is secret, for the highest level of security. And with the quadrant, I use each letter as a combination. So I have a changing table all the time. And that gives me a whole different encoded sentence. Of course, don't use spaces in your message. That's why I used colors. But don't use spaces in your message, because if you do, you're giving away information again. Because it's a logic. Spaces are logic. No remarks or whatever. Exchanging the passphrase, I already said it, that's really a pain. It's really difficult to do this exchange. And suppose that we all want to email with each other. How many shared keys do we need here? A whole bunch, yeah. I mean, if you really want to be secure, you have a shared key between each and every person. It's different. Ultimately, this can... I always get emotional at this point, if you can crack something, but this can be cracked. So if you've got a longer passphrase, it makes it harder to crack. But still, the passphrase repeats itself. So if I've got enough data, ultimately you can crack this. There's still logic in there. And that's why we have AutoKey. AutoKey is using the message itself as the key. And that's a really fun part, because I take the keyword security. The message is, this is an important message. So my rolling keyword is security, this is an important message, blah, 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 blah. So the message itself is part of the encryption mechanism. So that helps you raise the bar a little. Am I still talking sense to you? If I'm not, you just say to me. Another way of doing it is taking your alphabet and giving them an arbitrary number. The idea behind it is that if you give a whole bunch of numbers to the E, for instance, you have a whole bunch of numbers to pick from. So it's harder to find the logic. But at the end of the day, this is not the most secure way of doing it. How am I doing on my time? Oh, still good. At the end of the day, characters are still replaced, and that's it. if I find the secret, the mechanism is cracked. It's that simple. If I'm experienced enough, I can crack messages. So I need maybe to shuffle the text as well. This can be done, for instance, by the so-called Biffit table. You still use a passphrase to create the secret and the randomness, but I use it in a different way. And my message is, I understand cryptography. I'm going to prove a whole bunch of things here. So my word is hackers conference. Now, if I look at it, I start using all the characters from the word hackers conference. And when I'm done, I start adding the characters in alphabetical order, the same way as they are missing. So the B is missing, the D is missing, etc. As you know, our alphabet has 26 characters. So we need to pull a little trick here, and that's right here with the X and the Y. I still wonder how Chinese people would do this, because they've got so many characters, but that's not for me to worry about. So now I start to work with this table, and my message was, I understand cryptography. Horizontally, this is 4-1. Look, let's look for a second. Oh.
4.
I'm mistaken. Yeah, no. 4-3. No. Yeah. I fucked up. Sorry. Yeah, indeed, you're right. It's past Sesame Street, I told you. Yes, so basically you go find it in the table, and then comes the interesting part. I get a whole bunch of numbers, and I chop them into two pieces. So 41, 42, I've heard that number before, 42. 25, 12, 20, 52, etc. And now I place them in one big line, and I start using these numbers in the same table again. So 4-1 will become a K. And now, because of the horizontal and the vertical part, I'm shuffling the characters by just using a table of 5x5. Fits into your wallet. And encrypted, you get blah, 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 DRM, blah, blah, blah. And this proves it to me. This proves that cryptography is evil because DRM is in it. You see, with a couple of very, very simple tools, you can do quite a reasonable level of security. You can really print this out, put it in your wallet, and you've got an encryption device with you all of the time. And you can do it yourself. So, now what? I do it, yes, sometimes. But not all of the time. Honestly, not all of the time. But I do it sometimes, yeah. Now you know all about cryptography, and you're all cryptographers now. Play with it, use it. Not only because of you can put it in your wallet, but these mechanisms are not too complex for you to understand. It's really easy to use GPG, for instance, to encrypt your emails. Do it, it's there. If you've got a Macintosh, file vault to encrypt your files on your computer is one button that you have to click. Even you can do that. I could, so you can do it as well. Learn more. Learn about PKI. And please, if you know, if you're high, at a higher level, please help encoding. And this is the point where I want to refer to my talk of yesterday about data retention. A couple of people have approached me, and we're starting up an open source project to work on a privacy toolkit. And I'm looking for people who can do something, coding, typing, shouting, beating somebody up, whatever. If you can do something, we can use it. And please mail me or ask me, or let's start. We've got a year before data retention starts, so we can disrupt a whole bunch in a legal way. Help working on user-friendly encryption technologies. I keep hearing from family members that encryption is Japanese to them. So we have to translate that more, so that more people start using it. There is an additional benefit of a high amount of people using encryption. One, it's harder to forbid. Secondly, it's hard to distinguish unimportant messages from important messages. Because which message should I start decrypting as a government? Don't, of course, you shouldn't make out of a whole bunch of email the one email with this is top secret. I mean, that's not too smart, but furthermore, it's very hard to make the difference. Use it in any way you can. Sorry, I start talking Dutch. And don't stop defending our civil liberties. That's basically why I'm out here this year. That's the most important part. If you want to know more, subscribe to my English monthly newsletter. It will be a lot shorter than I used to write about it because of lack of time. At the Dutchies in the room, I've got a Dutch podcast. In 10 to 15 minutes, you hear the latest gossips on the ICT industry. Subscribe to it. Oh, you don't need to take a picture for that. I've got my website. It's on dwinter.com. If you go there, my whole presentation is there. Sorry? Oh, okay, sorry. I'm trying to save him a lot of work and editing and... Okay, that's just about it, what I have. Are there any questions, remarks? Are you angry? Are you not angry? Whatever. The podcast is in Dutch. The newsletter will be only English. I told the Dutchies to fuck off and go to the podcast just 2 days ago, or 3 days ago. Any questions on cryptography or the social part of it? Maybe somebody who can give that person in the red shirt, who wants to be anonymous but is called Peter Rosemaal.
Is there a cipher or a crypto algorithm which can be done by hand and which is secure? More secure than just CISA? Or?
I guess that the BIFID table is the one that is pretty secure, because you have to know the table, and that's something you can write it down, but you also can do it by from your mind. You don't really have to write it down. If you use a single code word, you can do it out of your head, if you're good. But, yeah? Thanks. He says that any type of this type of substitution is crap. Of course, if you run it, it's not, but it's somewhat secure.
Why is
okay, well, to be honest, from the average policeman in the Netherlands, you can keep it away.
Well,
yeah.
Yes. That,
that's a very good one. Actually, I should have put it in my presentation, but I thought it would be short on time, which turns out not to be true. Bruce Snyder has in his book an excellent part to use solitary as a means to do encryption. It's absolutely worthwhile reading.
That's what I wanted to say. It's in the book Cryptonomicon. There's an article from Bruce Schneier describing this algorithm.
Yeah.
I have one critic to the hangman example. The number of letters you substitute in Caesar, for example, is 13. But if you take a different number, that is already a key. So Caesar, route 13 is nothing else but a fixed key, but it's still a key. It's a key that has to be exchanged in some means.
Yes.
So keys didn't start in 1553. Well, if it's only 25 or 26 possibilities or 25 factorial possibilities, it's still a key.
You're right. Of course, the delta is a key, but I guess
technical detail.
Yeah. Technical language detail, which I should have got better as a journalist. Yeah, I know. Over there.
I have a question. If I want to send an encrypted email to a friend somewhere on the other side of the world, how do I tell him how to decrypt it? I mean, somewhere there is a weak spot, and do I have to get all into this PGP stuff to do it, or?
Not necessarily. The other alternative is, of course, to go to CA Cert. You get such a certificate, but somebody nowadays need to know at least something about encryption. So yeah, you need to point them to a website or to a wiki or whatever, explaining how it works. And yes, the downside is they have to install software. So maybe if it's that type of secure communication, you might want to look at a secure website with personal messaging. For instance, not being PHPBB. Yeah?
I have a little question. Do you know a public key encryption algorithm which can be done by hands?
No. And if anybody does, please let us know. Yeah, okay, with enough effort, of course, you can, yeah. What? Yeah, but that, yeah, okay, but I guess that a part of the question was in a way that is really doable for most people.
Well, RSA is not that good. It can be related by others, but you can't see that.
That's.
It's not secure enough to be reasonable once you do it by hand.
Well, to be honest, anything you do by hand will not be very secure because a computer can do so many calculations in.
Yes.
Okay, a one-time password is the only unbreakable system. Yes. Okay, I guess that basically sums it all up. Once more, I really sincerely hope, and that's really the aim of my talk, that you go out, use it, help other people with it, and basically start protecting our civil liberties. That's why we're out here. That's why we need to talk about it. Thank you.